All right, so now we're going to have a look at lathes and turning operations. So first we have to talk about what a lathe is, and at its core it's really pretty simple. You take a workpiece, generally a cylindrical workpiece, but not necessarily a cylindrical workpiece, and you spin that around its an axis, and then you guide a cutting tool in, and that cutting tool will shear off a chip, a layer of metal, off of that part. So at its simplest, it's just sort of a machine that spins a part and allows you to guide a tool in there. And historically they kind of started off this way. This is a jeweler's lathe, kind of one of the more simple lathes that you can buy. And but they took a big step forward around the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. In fact, lathes were probably one of the main drivers of the Industrial Revolution. When you're able to actually machine cylindrical parts very efficiently, it's a great step forward. So a lathe is a machine that can almost build itself. If you have a lathe and a mill, you can build lathes and mills. So the big step forward here is the fact that you're able to actually control the tool. All right, so now not only is the part spinning, but you can accurately control the location of this tool and guide the tool as the part rotates. And so this is Henry Maudslay's screw cutting lathe, one example of an early lathe that actually had control of the tool itself. So you're not just spinning the part, but you're spinning the part and guiding the tool by the machine itself. So this is an engine lathe, all right. So this is a South Bend 14 engine lathe, and I'm going to kind of use it as our generic way of talking about a lathe, because it has most of the features that that any lathe that you're going to buy nowadays has, and I did a model of it, so it's handy for me. So not all lathes are laid out exactly like a South Bend 14, but this will give us some talking points. But at any rate, this South Bend 14, this is an engine lathe, and it's sort of the general purpose lathe is an engine lathe, okay? And the originally these were run off of you had several of these in a facility that was powered by water, and you had the water wheel, and that mill would have a big shaft down the middle of the facility. And they would run these things off of leather belts that were attached to that shaft. There you go. Through the magic of the internet, I've got this Harper's Weekly image that shows, how this would work. And, later they moved from having to be based on a water mill to being able to be positioned anywhere because they had steam power. So so this is an engine lathe, and it was powered, by something other than the operator. And the term engine, some people argue, comes from the fact that it was run off of a steam engine, and that may very well be. There's also the distinction of an engine lathe and the fact that it actually controls the tool, so it's actually guiding the tool through a series of gears, so that gear train makes it an engine lathe. So I'm not going to hold you to either one of those as the origin of the definition, as long as you know that an engine lathe is a good sort of general purpose lathe. Typically, we don't refer to CNC lathes as being engine lathes. We're going to talk about a manually operated lathe as being an engine lathe. Now, as we move along, sort of progress from a tool that just spins apart, and then we've seen sort of historically that we were able to control the movement of the tool. And, as people developed engine lathes, they realized that they could automate some of the tasks of those engine lathes. Now, I'm not talking about CNC technology here. I'm talking about very old technology, a 1900s technology. Realized that you could take and automatically index from one tool to the next. Okay, and so this is an example of a tool that does that. This is an engine lathe. No, it's not. This is a turret lathe. And this is it's adapted so that it can index from one tool to the next. All right, so this is sort of a step forward in the world of automation. Now, as turret lathes were developed, they realized that we could actually bump this up one more notch and not only index from one tool to the next, but we could also control the motion of the cutters. All right, and so the automatic lathe was born. And I think it's important to talk about automatic lathes. These are usually called screw machines. But the term automatic lathe is not talking about a CNC machine, not a computer-controlled machine, but a programmable lathe that was programmed not with bits and bytes, but with cams, okay? And cams that would actually control the motion of the cutter and index the machine or the tools in and out. All of this stuff that you see here, this is not that's not a computer controlled lathe. That is a an old Brown and Sharp screw machine. All right, so this is a type of automation, and you know, sort of the next level of automation. Now, as these were progressing, as turret lathes and screw machines were progressing, there were, and still are, very good uses, cases where you would want to use a manual machine. So you still have engine lathes, manual engine lathes being made today because they're still very useful to have around. You know, in a machine shop where you have lower production quantities, you know, maybe one-off stuff like job shop things where you have a, you're going to make one of a particular part. When you start to make two and three and four, if they're not washers or something very simple, then it starts to make a lot of sense to use a CNC or a computer-controlled lathe. But it is good to know about this sort of intermediate step here that the automation went through for a very long time, you know, over 100 years, where we had machines that were driven by cams instead of being driven by, you know, CNC by computers. These were pre-computer-controlled. They were completely automated. These things you'd set up and they'd run, you know, for hours making parts. But to program one required that you would actually machine very specifically shaped cams. So just a nightmare to program, really. All right, and it's what's called hard automation. Okay, another type of lathe is a vertical lathe, and these lathes are what you would use if you have a very heavy workpiece, so a very large, bulky workpiece. You know, on the other lathes, the engine lathe that we saw earlier, like this, you know, the part is mounted horizontally like this, so it's mounted in this direction. Well, if you have a really heavy part, then gravity is working against you. But if you fixture on a vertical lathe, then you have gravity is actually helping you to hold the part, so gravity is working to keep this part in position on the lathe. So you would use a vertical lathe when you have a really large workpiece, and gravity is on your side when you have that workpiece oriented vertically like this. And of course, you're cutting tools out here either on the outside or on the inside, sometimes simultaneously inside and outside. All right, so this final step of automation is when we have this soft automation, when we have computer-controlled lathes, CNC lathes, that where you send a signal out to the lathe, and the lathe will move the tools and the parts and do the cutting under computer-controlled. So this is, real quick, that's just an example of CNC lathe. So you don't have a person that's dialing in the motions with hand wheels, and you don't have to have cams that have been machined to control the motion. The motion is completely dependent on the signal coming from the computer. There is another type of lathe, and this is not really a sequence of automation, but this is a different orientation of a lathe. Okay, so this is a Swiss lathe, and the thing that's different about a Swiss lathe is the fact that this motion, the motion along the axis of the part, does not come from moving the tool left and right. You see, when we saw this last one here, most lathes, if they're not Swiss lathes, no matter what they are, if it's a screw machine, well, that's a bad example. But if it's a if it's an engine lathe, if it's a CNC lathe, typically the tool moves along the axis left and right. But on a Swiss lathe, the motion comes from moving the actual part in and out. So the motion along the axis comes from pushing the part out into the tool, and the tool remains relatively stationary, and the part is fed into the tool. And I will just mention that a lot of Swiss lathes get called screw machines nowadays because they do a lot of the tasks that a screw machine would have formerly done. But anyway, they'll call them Swiss machines or Swiss turn. But the Swiss lathe, the thing to know about it is that that's the motion along the axis of rotation comes from moving the part and not from moving the tool. The tool only moves up and down, and the part moves into the tool. There is another type of tooling on lathes. This is pretty much strictly CNC lathes, although not exactly, but for the most part. And that is live tooling. So live tooling is tooling that will rotate, and you can have things like drills and mills do secondary operations on a workpiece inside of a lathe if you have live tooling or driven tooling. All right, so we're going to talk about some of the major lathe components, and I would... I'll refer you out. I think I've got another slide later, but there is a link on the lecture slides to a quiz game that will have the same image that will be on the test. So if you know, it's a little bit hard sometimes to point out the various features on a lathe for test-taking purposes. So if you'll take that quiz game, you'll see the identical lathe that will be on the quiz, and you can go ahead and get used to where the different components and how they're labeled on that diagram. So these are the major components. You've got the headstock here at this end, and the headstock is going to have all of the gear train and the belts and or gears that will drive the different systems here. And most of what you're doing is you're spinning the spindle round. So the spindle is the main rotating element up here in the headstock. So here we have the headstock, we have the bed, tailstock, we have this carriage that has different components on it, but those are the big main parts, and we'll break these down as we go here. There's also a version of the slides that kind of goes through and shows you these components in a little bit better detail than this lecture. All right, so here's the bed, and the bed is sort of the main big casting of the lathe. It's going to form the major structure of the lathe, and on the bed you see are the ways. So let me just come in here. All right, the ways are these polished surfaces on the bed. All right, and what happens with these ways are sometimes called bed ways. Is the various things that need to slide along the axis of the machine are mounted so that they ride on those ways. All right, so you can see kind of how that's set up. So if you want to have the sliding motion back and forth, this is the carriage and this is the tailstock. They will slide on the ways, like I said, sometimes called bed ways. And sometimes people will refer to them by the type of way that they are, like you may have box ways or V ways or dovetail ways. But anyway, those are the ways. Now, there are different types of beds and different configurations of lathe beds that are probably important to know about. One is a gap bed lathe. So a gap bed lathe allows a larger swing. Okay, so what is swing? The swing is the diameter of the largest workpiece that that lathe can handle. And there are different ways of specifying the swing. This is the swing over the ways. Sometimes people will talk about the swing over the saddle or the carriage, or the swing over the cross slide, or the swing over the compound to talk about how large a particular lathe is. If you just say the swing, you're probably talking about the swing over the ways. Now, some lathe manufacturers offer this feature. It's called a gap bed lathe that allows you to actually take a portion of the bed out and allow for a larger swing. And this would be the swing over the gap. So when you're buying a lathe, when you're trying to look for a lathe and you see the swing listed, you need to know whether you're talking about the swing over the gap or the swing over the ways. Also, there are sliding gap ways that actually allow you to open and close this gap up. Those are pretty interesting. Now, you can also have a bed that is slanted. So a very common orientation for CNC lathes is to have a slant bed lathe. And this does a couple of things. One is it allows the chips to fall out of the way nicely because they're not, this is not a flat surface. And generally, there are covers on this, so you don't actually have the ways exposed like this. You have way covers. But this allows the chips to fall out of the way, which is nice. It also uses less floor space because, you see this hypotenuse here is now lifted up, so you don't have that extra width. And it also provides a nice rigid arrangement where gravity kind of works to position the tailstock down against the ways. All right, the next bit is the carriage. So the carriage is this large piece in the middle. So really, all of this collectively would form the carriage. It's the big piece in the middle that's going to slide back and forth on the ways. All right, so on the lathe, there are different components, okay? This front piece of the carriage is called the apron. And the apron has these different controls on here. I'll talk about those in a minute. The top part of the carriage is called the saddle, okay? And what rides on the saddle is this, which is called the cross slide. So the cross slide moves in and out on top of the saddle. And then on top of the cross slide is this thing called the compound rest. So the compound rest allows you to cut tapers. It allows you to cut at an angle. So you can actually bring the tool in and out and cut a taper, and we'll talk about those in a minute. And then on top of the compound is the tool post. So this constitutes the tool post. This is what's going to actually do the holding of the cutting tools. Now, on the apron, we have different controls here. Now, this hand wheel is going to control the motion along what we call the Z axis, along the actual axis of rotation back and forth on the lathe. This hand wheel will control the motion in the cross slide. So this would change your diameter, for instance. So this will move the tool in and out in the radial direction. And the other hand wheel, like I said, this is going to control the compound. That's going to let you cut tapers and angled cuts. Now, we said that that the carriage is powered. The way that it gets power is through this device. Now, on a lot of lathes, there are two of these, okay? Those two things would be, if there were two, they would be the feed rod and the lead screw. Now, this lathe has them both combined, and I've got some slides on that, so I'll break off and go to that. All right, the feed rod is one way to get power into the carriage, and here is, this is going to be the feed rod. The feed rod is this rod that has a keyway in it, so it's got this keyway machined in that rod, and it goes into the carriage. And here's what it does inside the carriage. It takes and it turns a worm gear that rides on that feed rod, and that worm gear will transmit power into the carriage through a series of gears. And you can choose whether you want the power from the feed rod to go into moving the carriage back and forth, left and right, or you can go into feeding the cross slide direction. Now, the way that you select which direction the power from the feed rod goes is on this lathe, it's with this device right here. Okay, so this, but you're gonna pull this lever out, and you're gonna put it in either the top position, the middle position, or the bottom position. Okay. And the middle position is going to be neutral, but the top is going to let you, it's the kind of thing you can do without thinking. I think the top sends it to the cross slide, and the bottom sends it to the carriage. But the neutral position is for the other way of powering this the lathe. Well, let me go back. There's still one more part of this I got to talk about. So if the power from the feed rod is coming in here and it's moving the lathe left and right, okay, if it's powering the motion of the carriage, not the cross slide, but the carriage feed, then what it's doing is it's turning this rack and pinion. It's turning this pinion gear, and it's pushing against this rack. And you can see that in here. There's the rack underneath, okay, and you've got there's a pinion gear inside there that's going to turn that. All right. Now, this is going to tell you whether you're feeding in the carriage direction or the cross slide direction. So that's your power feed selector lever. Then this is the clutch, and this clutch is going to either engage the power or disengage the power. So this rod is going to be turning, and whether or not you're feeding in this direction or that depends on, first of all, whether you have the feed rod, the feed selector switch in the right position, and whether or not this clutch is engaged. So you on this one, you pull this clutch to engage the clutch and send the power so that it's actually going to move the carriage or the cross slide, depending on the feed selector. All right, so that was the feed rod. The other way of sending power to the carriage is through a thing called the lead screw. So the lead screw, similar look, see, there's the feed rod. The lead screw up here is actually threaded, okay? So it has what are called Acme threads on it. And there is a lever on the lathe called the half nut lever. Let me just show you that. All right, there's the half nut lever on this lathe. Okay, so you don't want to trifle with the half nut lever. Some lathes will have it locked out so that you can't engage it accidentally in the wrong setting. Some do not, so do not trifle with the half nut lever. That sounds like a quote for living. Okay, this is what the half nut looks like. All right, so it's actually it has a configuration of a nut that's been split in half, and when you engage the half nut lever, it clamps down onto that lead screw and starts feeding. So you're going to use the lead screw and the half nut lever only for threading. So if you're doing threading operations, this coordinates the motion of the spindle with the motion of the carriage. And so that allows you to cut threads using multiple passes and keeps the spindle and the carriage location coordinated. Okay, also on the headstock is going to be some way to control the speed and feed. All right, so the speed is going to come from the RPMs. That's how fast the spindle's rotating. And I've dropped over to this slide that's a little bit more modern than our South Bend 14, because our South Bend 14, the speed control is actually done with a it's got a variable speed pulley drive. So a lot of lathes will have you select the RPMs by the gear ratio, and that's what you see here on this one. So these are RPM settings to control the speed of the spindle. The other thing that they'll have are feed controls to control how fast the carriage moves, okay? And these are going to be, there's going to be a chart on the lathe that gives you numbers in inches per revolution. So how many inches or thousandths of an inch the carriage advances for each revolution of the spindle. All right, so this is, like I said, there's going to be an image on the test that looks pretty much just like this, okay? And the quiz game will let you go out and test yourself to make sure that you know the terms as they are labeled in this diagram. Let's see, so we'll talk a little bit about holding work in the spindle or in the lathe. One way is to mount pretty much anything that you're going to do that's going to hold any kind of work is going to mount onto the spindle nose, okay? So the spindle nose, this is the business end of the spindle. The spindle is the main rotating part. It's mounted in some big bearings, and it's turned by either gears or belts, hopefully gears. But it has a tapered surface on the inside here, so you can actually install tapered devices. And a lot of times it has an exterior taper here that like a chuck that we'll see will mount onto. And this is a cam lock arrangement here to hold a chuck in place. So this is the spindle nose. And some different things that you can put into the spindle. The most popular thing is this three-jaw universal scroll chuck. And so with this chuck, you put the workpiece in, and you just tighten with one of these little hex recesses, and that will clamp down on the workpiece. It'll move all three jaws at the same time so that your workpiece is always nicely centered. You can also have a four-jaw, an independent chuck. And these don't have to be three-jawed universal chucks. They have six jaws as well. But an independent chuck allows you to move each of the jaws on its own. So that allows you to, if you wanted to machine a hole or a surface that was eccentric, in other words, it had a different center line than the cylinder itself, it's sort of like the arrangement you'd have with like a camshaft or crankshaft. As a better illustration, then you can use an independent chuck. Or if you had like a square workpiece, you can use an independent chuck and allow it. You can move it back and forth in either direction. Also, a four-jaw chuck is really nice because it allows you to adjust out any kind of inconsistencies like you might get in a three-jaw chuck. So it's a little bit more precise if you take the extra time to do the setup. So this is a look at a scroll chuck. This is why it's called a scroll chuck. There's a link out to one of Mr. Pete's videos. Mr. Pete has a really good series of videos, if you're not familiar, where he rebuilds a scroll chuck, and you get to see sort of the inner workings and learn an awful lot about a scroll chuck. All right, another way of holding work in the lathe is to use a collet. So a collet is it's a work-holding device, and they tend to have threads on one end, and on a lathe, the threads are on the outside. This is like a 5C collet, and it has these split sort of fingers and a taper on the end. So what you do is you put your workpiece in here, and then as you tighten with the lathe will pull on these threads, and as it pulls, this taper pushes in on the... pushes in on the workpiece and clamps on it. This is a very repeatable setup, and you can get very nice, very well aligned concentricity with your workpiece and the actual spindle. So the limitation is that you have to have a collet that is designed for the diameter of the workpiece that you're trying to turn. So that's pretty much the limitation. Whereas with a chuck, you can adjust in, and you know, you can have a 1-inch workpiece in there. The next workpiece you could put in could be a 4-inch workpiece. But with a collet, these are for smaller diameters, and you have to have the right size collet for the diameter of the work that you're trying to turn. But this, notice this tapered surface. This is the spindle nose. Okay, so I said that the spindle has got that the spindle nose has this taper on the inside. And this is one of those tapered tools that fits inside of that spindle nose. All right, another way to turn on a lathe, and this is sort of an antiquated way. You'll still see it occasionally done, and you will see it done for like grinding operations, probably more than for turning operations. But this is, and also inspection purposes, because this is a very repeatable way to set up a workpiece. You see, we have these two centers on the ends. This is in the tailstock, and this one is in the spindle nose. But you put these two centers in. Now you have to have drilled into the end of the bar a nice tapered hole like this, and there's a special drill bit called a center drill that lets you drill those holes in there. But once you've done this, you can take this part out and put it back in, and it will just align near perfect over and over again. Now this little device here, let me slip to the next slide here, that's called a lathe dog, and that allows you to transmit torque to the workpiece, because you see, if you're just holding it between centers, the centers don't actually cause the workpiece to spin very well. In fact, you could probably just grab it with your hand and keep it from rotating. And so you use this thing called a lathe dog, and the lathe dog clamps on the workpiece, and it's driven by this thing called a drive plate. But there you can see sort of the setup. Here's our spindle nose. We have this tapered sleeve go in. We have a Morse taper on this center that slides in. Generally, this is a Morse taper too. It's like a really big Morse taper, and I'll talk about Morse tapers in a second. I know I hadn't done that. But you have this tapered arrangement allows things to go in and be nicely aligned concentrically. All right, so another way to hold work on a lathe is with a faceplate. So this is for generally boxy sort of work pieces that you need to bore or drill or turn. And you actually bolt your piece to a faceplate. All right. And when you have a long workpiece on a lathe, that workpiece will flex as you're trying to machine it. And there are two ways of handling really long workpieces on a lathe. One is called a steady rest, and this is a steady rest. The other is called a follow rest. Now the difference is, notice on the follow rest, it's actually mounted to the saddle here. It's actually going to follow the carriage as the tool goes. So this follow rest is going to be moving at the same speed that the tool is cutting. All right, so it's going to hold on to the workpiece as you're cutting at the point of the cut. Now a steady rest will hold the work, but notice here it's connected to the bed, so it's not going to move. It's stationary, and it's going to hold this other end out here. So the other, you know, you also use a tailstock so to hold the other end out here a lot of the time. Now, if you had a really long bar and you needed to face the end off, then you might hold it with a steady rest. These are some other videos on work holding. Pretty good overview there. I'm not going to replay them here, but they're in the notes. Especially if you don't really understand what I'm talking about with a collet or how that works, this is good to understand that. All right, real quickly, we're going to go through some operations that you can do on a lathe. The most basic operation is straight turning. Okay, so that's just where you move the tool straight along the axis of the part, reducing the diameter by some amount. This is called right-hand turning. And notice if we wanted to go in the other direction, do this same sort of thing, it would require a completely different tool. And it would be called left-hand turning. When you buy these tools, they're actually labeled whether they're a left-hand or a right-hand and sometimes a neutral tool. But you need to know that this, moving from right to left, is right-hand turning. All right, we've already seen that tapers are pretty useful on a lathe. We've seen them holding stuff in the spindle nose and things in the tailstock. But this is an example of a taper. You see them all the time on machine tools. And the reason is that they do a great job of aligning two rotating parts together. So this taper means that you don't have to have the shaft be a little bit smaller than the hole and have a little gap around it. You can have zero gap, and these two can assemble together perfectly, and you can get really, really good alignment. So this is an example of a taper. This is the kind of taper that you see on a machine tool or a CNC machine that can eject the tapered part really easily. On older machines and on manual machines, like the lathes that we have downstairs, very common to see this thing called a Morse taper. So a Morse taper is a very, very shallow taper. You can see this is, it tapers 0.6 inches or so across a foot. That's a very shallow taper, but on a manual machine that's actually an advantage, because what that does is when you put this taper into this tapered holder in the spindle in the tailstock, it will grab on and lock. It will lock in place and not let go. All right, so a very similar thing holds lathe chucks on. It's called a Jacobs taper, but this is a Morse taper. I'll just jump up here. This is a very common taper that you see on machine tools, this 724 taper. And what that means is that the diameter is going to increase across 24 inches by 7 inches. So if you think of it as being zero here, by the time you get a taper that's 24 inches long, it will have a 7-inch diameter. Now, sometimes you'll see these called out by the and this is actually how you would measure it on a lathe. If you were going to turn this taper, you could have an indicator you could mark where 24 inches was, and you could see when that, you could measure as you move along how far out this is coming, and you could see that by the time you got here, it would be 3.5 inches away from the center. It'd be half of 7. Some people like to think of this in degrees, but it's much harder to measure something like degrees on a lathe. You can set up a sine bar and use it on a lathe like that. But the easiest thing is to use the 724, for instance. But if you were to break this down into an angle, you see it's a darn exact angle. All right, so a very, very hard angle to measure. That's a lot of decimal places. On a Morse taper, you see that we have this weird number across a foot. And the different Morse tapers have a different taper because when Stephen Morse designed this taper, he actually made physical artifacts, and those became the standard. The physical artifacts that he made became the standard. He was shooting for about 5/8 of an inch per foot, I believe. This is not, it's hard to believe he'd mess it up by that much, but anyway, they're not defined by a specific amount per foot to be a standard. There are tapers that do that. Well, the one we just saw, that 724, and I think a Jarno taper is that way. So a number 2 Morse taper has a different taper than a number 3, and it's a different size as well. But a number 3 is a nice general purpose. That's the size that you'll find in the tailstocks of our lathes downstairs. So how do you turn, make a taper like this on a lathe? This is a very, we saw this, a very exact thing. You can't just kind of estimate this. One way to turn a taper on a lathe is to actually offset the tailstock. So you can push the tailstock over a certain amount until you run an indicator back and forth across here and measure until you're getting the right amount of taper, and then you machine that taper on. You just move the carriage just feeds as normal, just feeds in a straight line. But with the tailstock set over, that cuts on a taper. Another way of doing a taper, I don't have it on here. Another way of doing it is with the compound rest. Let me show you that. All right, the compound rest on a lathe, you can actually, loosen a couple of binding screws on here, and you can actually rotate the compound rest. And when you rotate it, you see that allows you to move in and out, and that doesn't show it very well. But you move this in and out, and that allows you to cut whatever angle you've set on the compound. So you feed in and out with this hand wheel, and you get you'll be cutting on a taper. So this is good for really short tapers and generally steeper tapers, and maybe tapers that are not you can do a pretty accurate taper on here if you take the time to set it up properly, but generally for a shorter taper. Yet another way to turn tapers on a machine, on a manual machine. So on a CNC machine, you would just program the path, but on a manual machine, this was a first-class way of turning tapers back in the day, and that was with a tapering attachment. And so the tapering attachment is this this plate that will swivel, and so you can loosen this. Has two binding screws on here. You can loosen that up, and you can change the angle of this swivel plate. And what you will do is actually lock in so that the motion of the cross slide is no longer driven by the hand wheel, but it's driven by the motion of the taper attachment. Okay, and I've got a couple of videos here that will show you that. So there's the swivel plate in the back, and you can see it's actually moving the tool in and out as it slides along the axis. Now, one of the great things about using a tapering attachment is the fact that you can use the power feed and get a real nice consistent cut. When you use the cross slide or the compound rest, the compounds generally don't have a power feed. But here you can see I can actually move this whole tapering attachment to where I need to, and it has about 8 or 9 inches of travel at least that allows you to cut a taper and a nice long taper, much longer than this taper even. Not that that one's anything to write home about. But this is a taper. I've set it up to a really extreme angle so you can kind of see what's going on. But you can see that out here, it's as it moves along that swivel plate, it is controlling the motion of the tool. It's moving the cross slide in. And what's nice about this, you can disconnect from this there's a knob back here, this knob right here. You can disconnect that knob and just use the lathe as normal and leave it set up to cut a Morse taper. In fact, our lathe down in the lab is set up on a number 3 Morse taper, and I just leave it that way. All right, so I can turn number 3 Morse tapers at will. All right, then there is facing. So facing is when we're moving radially across the end or the face of the part. So we're going to just clean up the face of the part. Contour turning is when we turn across a sort of a non-linear tool path, and this is best done on a CNC machine. There's form turning. So form turning is when you have a tool that has the shape that you want to impart on the workpiece. All right, so this is one way to get nice sort of unique shapes on a manual machine, is to actually have a tool that has that profile cut in it. This is sometimes called forming. We're going to try to just call it form turning in this class because we learned earlier a term for forming. And forming, as we discussed it earlier, means to plastically deform a part, to actually bend a part. But we're not going to use it in that sense. We're going to call this form turning, but just so you know, a lot of people will call this forming. So this is some other examples of form turning tools. Then if you want to eliminate the end of a part, if you want to actually cut it, it's like a sawing off operation, that's called parting or parting off. And this is a parting tool. And a parting tool is generally a long, skinny tool. And things can go wrong pretty quickly when you're parting off. But you'll notice there's a little angle to this, and that's because as you part off, you're going to leave a little nip behind, a little pip on here. And you can set this up so that you either have a tool that leaves the pip on the part that comes off, or it leaves the pip on the stock that you cut the part off of. And you can see that would be two different tools. You can also drill on a lathe by holding the drill bit still in the tailstock, or in a chuck in the tailstock, or just you have tapered drill bits you can just install in the tailstock, and spinning the part. All right, so drilling, pretty commonly done on a lathe. Now, a little nicer than drilling, but a little bit more involved, is boring. So if you bore a part out, you go in, first of all, you drill the hole out, but drilling with a twist drill is really just a roughing operation. You can follow that with what's called a boring bar. So here you see that boring bar on the inside of the work, and you're increasing the diameter of a previously drilled hole. And you can do this, you can get a nice precise diameter with a really good surface finish by boring. All right, you can also do threading on a lathe. This is done with, like we saw, if you're on a manual machine, it's done with that half nut lever by setting the lead screw up to move a certain number of inches per revolution, or parts of an inch per revolution. You can do internal threading as well, sort of the boring corollary there. You can do grooving or necking. Knurling is when you impress this sort of nicely patterned feature onto a work piece, and that can be done two ways. One, it can be done by forming, and when I say forming, I mean literal forming, by plastically deforming the material. And you can also have cut lathes, or cut knurls. You can have a tool that actually cuts that knurl shape in. But you'll see knurls, for features that need to be, have a nice grip on them, like certain thumb wheels and things will have knurls on them. You can also knurl a part that's going to be press fit, so you can increase the diameter of a part ever so slightly by knurling it, and then you can press fit it into a hole. All right, so be able to recognize those operations. I didn't talk about reaming. We'll talk about reaming when we look at drilling and hole making. So we mentioned the tool holder. There are different ways of holding tools on a lathe. This is sort of the old classic way of doing it. This is sometimes called a lantern style tool post. Sometimes you'll hear them called rocking washer tool post or rocky washer tool post. But a lantern style, I think, is probably the sort of the most standard way to refer to these. And you can see that you could actually adjust a lot of features of that tool. You know, the orientation angles and things. A manual turret style tool post is also a pretty handy thing. So you can put up to four cutting tools in here, all previously set and arranged, and you can index from one to the other. And like I said, you got four stations in here. This one just has two installed, but that allows you to change real quickly between those four. My favorite is the quick change tool post. And the way you do this, there's two different things that you can adjust here. Well, three really. You've got this lever, and on our machines, it has a big red knob on there. You can't miss it. So you pull that knob to you, and that will release this tool block. And you can take that tool block out and put it in, replace it with another one. And you can see here the height can actually be adjusted on those tool blocks. So when you take it out and put it back in, it's pre-adjusted, and then you just clamp down. Now, if you need to change the actual angle of the tool, you can rotate that thing. That big nut on top allows you to rotate the actual position of the tool. And you may have to do that in lab, so get used to the difference between what happens with that knob on the top and what happens with the, or the nut on the top and what happens with the knob. So the knob is to change tools. The nut is to change the position of the tool, the rotation of the tool. Completely separate from the rotation you get on the compound. So the compound allows you to adjust the angle of the path, but the nut on the tool post lets you change the angle of the tool, and that'll change what's called the lead angle. More on that later. All right, so some things to know about lathes when you're buying them. One is horsepower, and that's going to involve knowing how much metal you're trying to remove per unit time, what volume of metal per unit time you're trying to remove, and also the specific horsepower of that metal. Some metal, it takes more horsepower to remove a certain volume per unit time than other metals. So it will take more horsepower to remove 1 cubic inch of steel per minute than it would take to remove a cubic inch of aluminum, say, per minute, for example. Then the swing we talked about, that's the maximum diameter that can be rotated on the lathe. We told you to watch out for gap bed lathes and make sure that you know which swing you're looking at. And then also the maximum distance between centers. We saw a part mounted between centers. All right, so since centers were such a traditional way of holding work, they got used to sort of define the length of a lathe. So the length is the distance between centers. That's, you know, it's the bed length. And then finally, the spindle bore. So you need to know, you know, if you're bringing, if the work needs to actually extend up into the headstock, then it will need to extend through the spindle. So this is the spindle bore. And, you know, sometimes you'll need work to actually go up into, up through the chuck, into the headstock, and maybe a little bit beyond. Not too much beyond, though, because those can bend and whip and spin around. You'll see in lab, the very first lab we have, that we'll have a workpiece that's too big to go into the spindle bore. All right, so that's sort of one of the final things that you need to know about specifying a lathe. And there, you know, really there's a lot more than that, but that's a good sort of the most important low-hanging fruit. All right, so that's it for the introduction to lathes. We'll start talking about doing specific speed and feeds, putting in specific numbers into the lathe to get the results that we want next time.